Hello, everyone, and welcome to our From the Field webinar series. I'd like to thank our From the Field sponsor, Hilda and David Cuter, who sponsored this video in memory of Viktor Bakhtin, a Russian artist who did beautiful images of cranes and wildlife around the world. If you'd like to learn more about our webinars, you can contact Kate Fitzwilliams. You can also go to ICF's website and see what's available to view. Next. My name is Claire Morandi. I've worked at the International Crane Foundation for over 30 years and worked very closely with the people you'll be hearing from today. First, it's my great pleasure to introduce George Archibald, who founded the International Crane Foundation and has worked closely with Russia since the 1970s when he became with Dr. Vladimir Flint, the father of ornithology for your country. He has been out to the field many times and found and trained many people. George, would you like to start us on our migration journey? Thank you.
Yes, good morning, everyone. This is George Archibald. Next slide. I'm happy to be with you today with my Russian colleagues and to talk to you about the migration of cranes. For times untold, the migration of cranes has enchanted people with their coming in the spring and their departure in the fall and the great distances they cover. Next slide. They soar high in the sky using flapping, and then they reach a certain height and fix their wings and glide for hundreds of miles in a single flight effort. And the juvenile cranes, the bird in front is the brown bird, the juvenile, always accompanies its parents, and they stay together through migration and through the winter. And even they come back together in the springtime. Next slide. The Siberian crane has one of the longest migration routes of cranes, about 4,000 miles between the breeding grounds on the tundra of Russia and wintering on the Yangtze lowlands of Iran, of China. Next slide. The several species of cranes migrate over high mountain ranges. Here we have demoiselle cranes that breed in Mongolia, migrating over the Himalaya mountains. The black-necked cranes and Eurasian cranes also migrate at astounding altitudes over these mountains. Next slide. Today we're going to talk about the migration of the Siberian crane. The black circle indicates the breeding area on the tundra of Russia. And from that, they migrate in late summer over several mountain ranges, and they converge on a river called the Aldan River that leads south towards China. The yellow line is the migration route. And you can see how they're coming together at one point. And that point is a little village called Okhotsky Perevoz. It's quite a wonderful accident that so many birds should fly over that village. And that village is a very important place historically because it's where the horse trains would leave carrying materials to the Pacific Ocean, to the city, to the town of Okhotsk. So it was the link between this part of Eastern Siberia and the outside world. It was a major trade route. There used to be about 5,000 people lived there, but now there are fewer, well, just over 100 people. Then from there, they don't really stop there. They just fly over that village, but we can count them. and they migrate almost in a straight line to this plain of northern China, where they rest for up to a month before flying onto their winter location. Next slide. And today we are delighted to have three of our foremost Russian colleagues with us to tell you the story of these cranes and of other cranes in Russia. And this is Dr. Elena Ilyashenko on the left, who heads the Russian Working Group on Cranes, and Dr. Masha Vladimirtseva, who is a head researcher on Siberian cranes and will be doing most of the talking in this little program, and Oleg Goroshka, who was up there. He works more in southern Siberia on white-naped and red-crowned cranes, but this year he had a chance to go up and work with Masha and Lena. Next slide. So Lena, you take it from here.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, George. I would like to first introduce you Crane Working Group of Eurasia. This Crane is public organization which bring together both professional ornithologists and bird lovers who are interested in crane conservation and protection. Next, please. In Russia, we have seven crane species, and I will talk shortly about them. The most numerous crane is sandhill crane. In Russia, its number also increased, and its range spread to the west, and now it's overlap the Siberian crane range. Next, please. The Eurasian crane is also very numerous and widespread species and abundant in Europe. But in Russia, in the European part, its number is decreased because loss of habitats. But interesting that in the Asian part, the number is increasing. Next, please. The demoiselle crane is also still numerous species, also widespread. It's inhabited in Eurasian steppe, but unfortunately, last decades, the number decreasing, mostly because drought, long-term drought, and the modernization of artesian wells. Next, please. The other four species are the Asian species, vulnerable or threatened, and one of them, hooded crane. But I would like to say that during the last decade, we learn more about this crane. This crane mostly breed in Russia and only small population in Northeast China. And according to the count in the wintering grounds, its number increasing. Next, please. The next species, white-necked crane. This species has two population, Western population, which breed, which winter in China and breed in Transbaikal, in Dauria. Therefore, it's named Daursky. And the eastern population spent winter in Korea and Japan and breed in the Primorsky region and Amur region. The number of Western population decreasing, while the number of Eastern population increasing. Again, the number of Western population decreasing because long-term drought. Next, please. The other species, red-crowned crane, is the most beautiful crane, but unfortunately, its number, it's rarest crane in the world. This species suffer from the loss of habitats, especially in valley of Amuriva. In Russian, its number, it's only 400-500 individuals. Next, please. And at last, the hero of our webinar, Siberian crane. It's also, as other white cranes, they also very rare. This crane has two population, is Siberian population on the right, which spent winter in China and breed in Yakutia, and West Siberian population, which breed in West Siberia and spent it winter before in India and Iran. And the West Siberian population has two flocks, central flock in Kunavat River basin and more west, south, western flock. Next, please. Next, please. A Siberian crane is Arctic resident. It's endemic of Russia. It's bred only in Russia. And when it arrives in the breeding grounds, everywhere snow. And it's difficult to survive in such difficult conditions. Next, please. Siberian cranes from central flock breed in the forest tundra. Next, please. While Siberian crane from western flock breed in north taiga, it's more forested area. Next, please. The cranes from the both breeding flocks started migration and in south direction, and they reach migration to Popova and Kazakhstan in Nauruzum Nature Reserve. And they can stay here almost months. Next, please. And after that, cranes from central flock go into India. And in 1970s, we can see more than 100 Siberian cranes in Keladeva National Park in India. Next, please. But unfortunately, this central flock almost extinct, probably disappeared because of hunting in Afghanistan and Pakistan, because Siberian crane flyway go over these countries. Next, please. And last Siberian crane breeding pair was in 2001 in Kunavat River Basin. It was called the pair of last hope. Next, please. And last time, this pair spent winter in Keladeva National Park in winter 2001-2002. After that, nobody see cranes there. And therefore, in India, in Keladeva National Park, it was set monument, which you can write, in your next life, you can be the endangered species. Help us to save Siberian cranes. Next, please. And Siberian cranes from Western flock spent winter in Iran, but its numbers also decrease very much. And last time we can see the family in Iran in 2003-2004. Next, please. And since 2009, only one Siberian crane arrived in Iran. And we are very glad to say that recently this Siberian crane again arrived in Iran. It is 12 winter when it spent winter alone in Iran. Really, it's only one bird here, but its crane is named in Hope in English and Nadezhda in Russian, Amit in Farsi. Therefore, we hope that this crane somewhere to bring more cranes here. Thank you.
This is the migration route of the eastern population of Siberian cranes. And Masha, are you going to take over from now?
Yes, George. Siberian crane, eastern population, breed in tundra zone in low reaches of the rivers Yana, Chroma, Indigirka, Alazeya. And every year, we study Siberian cranes at Indigirka River. We was founded National Park Kitalik. Kitalik means Siberian crane in Yakutian language. The breeding success of Siberian cranes depends on the late May, early June condition when cranes lay their eggs. Their home ranges are flooded, still covered with snow, or it is too cold and snowing, they have to delay or even refuse the egg laying, or eggs or chicks cannot survive. And next, please.
Just a second, Masha. This is George again.
Yes.
I made a mistake. Mm-hmm. I was going to talk. Can we go back to the previous slide? Okay, I'm sorry, Marcia. I forgot the sequence. I just wanted to explain that the Siberian cranes continue on from Russia to China, and they stop at those dots that you see up in northern China. They stop for up to a month, and we believe they build up their fat reserves for their next huge flight, which takes them over one of the most populated areas on Earth to this single lake, Poyang Lake, in the far south of China along the Yangtze River. Next slide, please. And here they are, one of the great spectacles in the world, between 4,000, 5,000 Siberian cranes all gathered together. And there are lots of challenges for the conservation of Siberian cranes along their migration route and on their wintering grounds. And that's what we're all working together to help solve. Next slide. And our Chinese colleagues are doing a great work in public education, especially with the young people, to help them appreciate the treasure that they have in nature in their beautiful country. Next slide. Okay, Masha, we'll come back to you now. I'm sorry for forgetting my spot.
It's okay, George. In this slide, you can see the territory of National Park Italy, Siberian crane main breeding ground. It is the low Indigirka River reaches. And next slide, please. And the 2022 summer beginning was very unusual for tundra birds. The tundra was not so wet as other years. It was much drier on Siberian crane breeding ground. It was warm and sunny, and rains were rare. Next, please. On the territory of about 1,000 square kilometers, our team watched 21 breeding pairs of Siberian cranes. Actually, we registered 22 pairs, but one pair didn't breed. They just occupied the territory. And 20 of these pairs incubated, and we could clearly confirm that 10 chicks were hatched. And but we could not see if other pairs also were successful with chick raising in late July because of the great distances between us and these birds, these pairs. And so we think that this part of the population which we watched was in optimal condition this year. Next, please. And the main territorial neighbors of Siberian cranes, this is tundra swans, sandhill cranes, and peregrine falcons, were inferior to Siberian cranes in number this year. In our study territory, we watched 14 tundra swan pairs, 10 sandhill crane pairs, and 7 pairs of peregrine falcon. Next, please. Mm-hmm. Thank you. The international collaboration for Siberian crane study in Yakutia began in late 1980s, when George Archibald and Yakutian ornithologist Yuri Labutin have met and discussed the marking, of Siberian crane eastern population. And in 1992, American scientists, David Ellis included, brought satellite transmitters in Yakutia. And two chicks were marked with this by Yuri Labutin's team. You can see Andrei Dikterev in this slide who participated also. And what is interesting, the signals from one of these chicks marked with satellite transmitter were received exactly from Okhotsky Perevoz village. Next, please. And in 2008, again, two young Siberian cranes were marked with satellite transmitters, and they both flied via Okhotsky Perevoz by the Dayden. Next, please. So Okhotsky Perevoz currently is a small village, as George said, just a little more than 100 people live there, and they support themselves with cattle breeding and with horse breeding. And only 11 school children study in the village school this year. Next, please. Okhotsky Perevoz is located in point where migrating Siberian cranes come to Aldan River Valley after overcoming of mountain ridges. When they fly from the tundra breeding ground to wintering ground in China. Okhotsky Perevoz is the bottlenecking of Siberian crane migration, because here the flyway narrows, and therefore a large numbers of migrating cranes can be seen here. Next, please. And also, as George said, historically Okhotsky Perevoz village establishment was associated with the need for a transit point. In the 18th centuries, this territory was located on an extremely difficult route from Yakutsk to Okhotsk sea coast, and the Cossacks and travelers, including representatives of the Kamchatka expeditions of Bering in 1740, rested here before the most difficult part of the way in the area of this village, Okhotsky Perevoz. And in the 17th century, Aldan River was used partly as waterway, and in 18th century, the way became ground mostly. Next, please. And the first migration counting expedition of scientists and nature protectors was happened in 2008. And this expedition and all next our expeditions were invited and hosted with wonderful people, Siberian crane migration volunteers. This is Rosa and Alexei Zilipuchins. Next, please. And the history of all Okhotsky Perevoz migration counting study started when Rosa Zilipuchina visited ornithologists in Yakutsk for the first time in early 2000s. And she said, she counted big numbers of Siberian cranes in her village, Okhotsky Perevoz, when cranes migrate there. She said, please come to my house in Okhotsky Perevoz. Stay there as long as you need and count cranes on their migration. Rosa was 17 years old when she arrived at Okhotsky Perevoz from the Western Russia as an engineer. She got married and stayed here. Next, please.
In 2018, I had the privilege of accompanying Jennifer Spears, a member of our board of directors, to this beautiful place. And here we are with Masha on our arrival near the home of Rosa. And we arrived a little bit too early. We only had a couple of days there, but we did see a flock of Siberian cranes. Next slide. And we made plans for our next year's work. From a nearby hill, you can see the Aldan River in the distance. And Okhotsky Perevoz is right on this side of the river. But Rosa and Alexei live on the other side. So we would have two teams, one on the rivers on either side of the river, watching the migration. And sometimes we would come up to this hilltop and the cranes were migrating over there as well. It's beautiful nature, just vast expanses of wilderness. Next slide, please. Here is the Aldan River. It was not frozen, of course, when we were there, but we had to be out by the 12th of October because as this river freezes, it's very easy to get caught in the ice. And it's a great problem for the Russian people to get you out of there by helicopter or whatever. So they are very strict that we had to be out by that time. But fortunately, the migration had ended. And just a few families on the last day as the snow came. Next slide. And our group of course were interested in all the other birds. This is a beautiful bunting that's found there. And we also saw lots of waterfowl and big migrations of white-fronted geese and bean geese. Following the Aldan River south. Next slide. And we were so touched by the hospitality of Rosa and Alexei. This is Jennifer Spears with us in 2018. They prepared all our meals and provided us with lodging. And we decided that this is such an important spot worldwide to see so many rare cranes fly over during the migration period that I decided I'll come back next year with another group. We did some programs in the school. Here are all the wonderful kids and presented little gifts that Masha had prepared for them. We call this sort of a mini Siberian crane festival. Next slide. And all day long, from sun up till sundown, the various teams would sit by the fire and watch to the northern sky. In 2019, we had quite a wonderful group, including scientists from China, from Russia, United States, and from France. Next slide. And we gave programs in the schools. If we could start the video here.
From the beginning, yes.
Hello, my name is Bob Dutton, and I'm from America. And I am coming here to enjoy your hospitality and to view your beautiful birds.
Yes, next slide. And as I said, winter descended upon us as those last families of Siberian cranes flew overhead. They were heading south. We were heading north by boat on the Aldan River to get back to Yakutsk. And we left behind this little village and soon they would be locked in by ice. But when it gets really cold, many weeks later, they're able to travel by car on the ice and get to various places. Next slide. Here we are, as we are leaving, we saw over 2,000 birds, and our colleague from China is showing the big banner of the Chinese Wildlife Conservation Association. And it's so important now that Russia and China cooperate together in making a secure migration route, a secure breeding area, and a secure wintering area for these beautiful birds. We all have to work together. Next slide.
Okay, thank you, George. Good morning, everyone. In Okhotsky Perevoz, we observed cranes from two points located on the two opposite river sides. Migration in 2021 was an unusually early date. Therefore, we missed the first wave of the migration with peak in September 25. Next, please. But we did observe the second wave of migration with peak in September 29. We have counted 1,984 Siberian cranes of the second wave, of which about 1,000 were counted in September 29. And local people counted 1,198 Siberian cranes before our visit to Okhotsky Perevoz. So 3,182 cranes were counted in Okhotsky Perevoz in 2021 in total. Next, please. We have determined the age of 763 cranes, of which 89 were juveniles with reddish feathers. Next, please. It is about 11.7% of observed population. Breeding condition for Siberian cranes in 2021 were not very favorable due to an unusually severe drought. It may reduce the breeding success of Siberian cranes. We look forward to the results of survey of number and studies of the proportion of juvenile Siberian cranes at wintering sites in China to compare with our studies on the flyway. Okay, thank you.
So when we added counting data from our volunteers to our own data from this autumn, we have got the second largest result after 2017, when we counted almost 4,000 cranes. The migration dates were unusually early this year. This autumn, we have a peak in the counted crane number on September 25 and 29, but other years' peak dates related to October. Next, please.
I would like to share you my impression of my visit to Okhotsky Perevoz in this year. And my thoughts is the following. The people in Okhotsky Perevoz always live together with Siberian cranes because they were the part of their nature. Besides, the Siberian crane is totem species for the Yakutian people and sacred bird. But they knew a few about these birds. And Masha and Rosa were the first who tell these people, the people of this village, about the Siberian cranes and about the importance of the place where they live. And George was the first who showed the importance of this place at the world level and invite the outstanding crane people. Next, please. And also I have very great experience because I'm lucky person. I have been in wintering grounds and breeding grounds. I have never seen before the Siberian crane migration. And next, please. You can see here the Siberian cranes. It's quite difficult to see. At first you can hear their melodic voice and they touch you style. And then you try to find these cranes in the sky because sometimes they fly very, very high. Next, please. And people from other places, now the, I would like to say that the Okhotsky Perevoz became the very famous place. And people from the Western Siberia come here. And the left, you can see the very important person from the Arctic Association. He lives in West Siberia, and his last name means crane in Nenetsky language, Nenetsky people in the West Siberia. And he come to Okhotsky Perevoz especially to see Siberian cranes. And it was very difficult because the migration almost over and the weather was very bad, and he came here only for 4 hours, but he was lucky and he saw the flock of Siberian cranes and he was excited. And he was excited because it's now it's not possible to see Siberian cranes in West Siberia, only in East Siberia. Thank you.
And we are very grateful for George Archibald for his great support of our expeditions to Okhotsky Perevoz and for his International Crane Foundation support to development of Okhotsky Perevoz Siberian Crane Migration Center. And I would like to express our gratitude to Rosa Zelipuchina and to her great and lovely family who supports and hosts all our expeditions in their house from 2008. And they also count cranes and collect that data from all our wonderful volunteers in Okhotsky Perevoz, and all our volunteers are very good bird watchers. I want to express my gratitude to them for all these years. And we invite all interested viewers to visit Yakutia to see and study Siberian crane migration at Okhotsky Perevoz. And for the future, we hope to find more passionate and dedicated locals to continue and develop the migration study. Next, please.
Yes, thank you, Masha. I just want to echo your words. And this is an internationally significant place where through the geography and the timing, all these birds migrate over this place. And I hope it can be called the Rosa Zapolutna Siberian Crane Migration Center, and that her dedication to the welfare of these birds will always be remembered through this center, and that for generations to come, people can come and see these beautiful birds, which perhaps for thousands of years have been migrating along the Aldan River. And a special thank you to Rosa and Masha. Thank you so much for all your work there. And Oleg and Elena, thank you for participating in the Big Crane Count this year. And we're looking forward to returning next year. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for taking us on this amazing journey with the Siberian cranes through East Russia and also in the central populations. Kids, we hope you've enjoyed learning something about this magical bird that's a deep part of your heritage and culture. And I want to also send my thanks to the Zelopukins, who are just absolutely amazing people, and invite people to join us on one of our next trips. A couple questions came up while we were listening to your talk. And Masha, we've been hearing a lot about the fires up in the tundra and taiga. Can you tell us a little bit about how this might be affecting the Siberian cranes?
This year, fires in tundra was no so large scale and intensive like in 2020 in last year. This year, there were some fire centers which and fire was interrupted very soon by nature, by suddenly rain. And so tundra was lucky this year in this relation. But taiga suffered a lot this year from fires. And last year, possible first for the 50 years, all tundra area, all tundra zone was embraced with a fire. And it was, of course, it was no good for tundra breeding birds, Siberian crane including. And our scientists registered one fact when a Siberian crane pair had to leave their breeding home range because of fire. And it was impossible to detect if they had a chick before, and possible they lost this chick. But even this fact that they had to leave, had to go further, this is confirms that, of course, fires. Fires have bad effect to breeding Siberian cranes. And so we hope the next years we will have lesser fires in taiga and no fires at tundra zone at all. Because nobody know, even nobody knows us what to do with this tundra fires rightly. What is the best way to interrupt these fires? Because we had no tundra fires for so long time period.
Okay, thank you, Masha. Yeah, again, we all watch this and we hope and pray that for next year and in future years, the cranes will be safe. Okay, another question. A lot of cranes we know gather before they migrate south. They're very territorial when they breed, then they become social and fly together. We're seeing that a lot with our sandhill cranes in Wisconsin now. Lena, do you know where the Siberian cranes gather before migration?
No, we still don't know about this. And I hope very much that the work our Chinese colleague will help us to learn about it, because our Chinese colleague fitted transmitters on the Siberian cranes, and after analyzing of the flyway, their route, probably we can understand where Siberian cranes gather, because in tundra and forest tundra, no such as wood fields where they feed, where they aggregated together. We don't know about it. But this is a mistake, and maybe in future we should learn about it.
Sure. Okay, another one of the mysteries of this bird, that if we can find out where they go, we know where to protect. So yeah, if anybody out there sees cranes gathering, please let us know. And Oleg, I have one more question for you. I understand that normally Siberian cranes are very rare in your area, but that you actually saw some more this year. Can you tell us a little bit about what you saw and why you think this is important? Tell us about the Siberian cranes that you saw in Daursky this year.
In Daursky?
Yeah.
It
was an unusual sighting.
Yes. Daursky is an important place for Siberian cranes that 1-2 years old. So these birds not breed, and they stay outside of a breeding area, and they like to stay very much in Daursky, in Daurian steppe, because it is an area with many wetlands, very rich forage resources. And Siberian cranes in Daursky stay by flocks. Usually it is not big flocks, from 3 to 10 birds, but sometimes we can see big flocks. For example, in this year, we saw flock about 50 Siberian cranes. It is biggest flock that we saw in Daursky. In total, the number of Siberian cranes increase year by year, and it show probably the increasing of global population of the eastern population of Siberian cranes.
Yeah. Well, thank you all. I guess it's also been a great mystery of where these non-breeding birds go. And I'm glad they chose to come by you. I know they're well protected. Well, thank you, everyone. I hope you've enjoyed today's seminar. And I also, we're looking for opportunities to bring school kids together from different parts of Russia and China. So if any of you are interested, please talk to Masha or Lena or Oleg, and we will be happy to involve you in these programs. And I just want to do a quick announcement too. ICF does regular webinar series. And if you would like, you can go to our website and join us on November 11th, where you could learn about some of the whooping cranes in North America. This is done by Liz Smith, who leads our North America program, and a Light and Conservation Fellow, a student named Rory Marks. And this is sponsored by a wonderful couple named Kathy and Tom Leiden, who have fallen in love with the cranes, including those over in East Asia. Okay, well, thank you, everyone. And I do want to remind you, this presentation of work is made possible by support of people like you. And thank you from the bottom of our hearts. And if you'd like to learn more, make a gift, become a member, please visit us at www.savingcranes.org. Спасибо.